want you to imagine is a soldier. It's not so hard that we've got Mark here, a strapping young man, well, you know, well-dressed, clean cut. And you would imagine them being in their fatigue, paid by the taxpayers to look up to serve their country. And if I asked you to imagine a child soldier, I guess the first image that comes to us is someone, a young child in Africa, a little boy who's impoverished, has little access to health or education, and most likely kidnapped or forced into serving the militants. So as a young child soldier myself at one point in my life, I don't fit any of those stereotypes. Firstly, I'm a female. Secondly, I come from a middle-class family that was well-educated, caring, and loving. The only stereotype I had to fit is becoming a doctor. You're not surprised, are you? I'm not sure. And no, I didn't become a doctor, actually. It is quite strange that someone like me would then run away from home and join a militant group that's claim to fame is the suicide belt. What drove me to it was injustice. So I wasn't paid, I wasn't kidnapped or forced into it, I volunteered. In fact, I had to beg them to take me in. And as a Tamil minority growing up in a majority Sri Lanka where we were randomly targeted, shot and killed, I just could not stand that any longer. And as I became a teenager, I spent more time in the bomb shelters, still doing my homework. And it came to a point, I was looking up to adults, asking them, you know, hoping that they would fix our problems. But no, what I saw was fear and obedience. And they kept saying, don't go out, it's curfew. Don't go out into this part of town because the soldiers will take you. Or don't talk about the militants because that's dangerous. You might be put in prison. So this is a picture of my best friend and her family. And the one before that was the daddy kid was me. Wearing a skirt up to her armpit. But my family was lovely, actually. So it was one of those things where I had enough, you know, and it's a society where you're brought up as it's a conservative society, where as a female you have enough restrictions. And on top of this, we had the war that's imposing more restrictions on us. And I had enough. And as Vicky quoted earlier, I think Emilio Zapata who said that it's better to die standing than live on your knees. And that's how I felt. That, it summed up pretty much how I felt. And I thought, if I'm going to die anyway, I might as well fight and then die. I didn't want to just die as a victim. And if adults are not going to fix my problem, I'm going to do something. And so when I told this to my friends, and my friends said, oh my God, you're going to give your family a bad reputation. And I said, corpses don't care about reputation. So I was going to go anyway. So my best friend said, I'll come with you, the one you saw before. And she said, I'll come with you because I don't want you to go on your own. So I said, fine. So we ran away against our family's wishes. And all I packed was a bag of books. I forgot to pack underwear or toothbrush. I just assume everything will be taken care of in a militant group. Hard lesson to learn for a teenage girl was going camping. So when I was there, I learned a terrible lesson. Things only got worse from that point. So we were given cyanide capsules. It's a little glass vial that every Tamil tiger had to wear when you get inducted. You wear it around your neck, and it's potassium cyanide. You bite into it, and death is instant. And I've seen that happen. And that's because they didn't want you to get caught by the enemy. So we were given 6 weeks training and an AK-47, the universal weapon of revolutionaries, and sent out to fight a well-organized government army. And we were ragtag teenagers, badly organized, and we had to fight them. I had no idea, and things just got worse and worse, and so came to a point that the government soldiers gained all control of territory. We were on the run, we were hunted 24/7, and we were sleeping in plantations, no food, and came to a point months later, I was wearing the same clothes. 5 or 6 months into it, I was wearing the same clothes because I had nothing else to change into. And you can imagine what it was like for a young girl to be in that place. It was very, very bad. And And slowly we started to lose comrades. Many of them started to die. And the worst day came when there was a big ambush and half of my platoon of 22 got wiped out. And my best friend who came with me, who you saw earlier, died right in front of me. And that was a point that changed my life. I guess you're never the same person again, because you were taught that you taught me once you enter the cycle of violence, it was never going to end, that it perpetuates itself. And there are lots of people who are just going to keep dying. And they're someone's children, someone's wife, someone's husband. And that's not the way it's meant to be. And at that point, I also realized those who glorify war are those people who never fought in it. And I decided to leave because I didn't believe in that ideology anymore, and I thought there has to be a better way. In this day and age, where we are supposedly so advanced, we have to find better ways to solve problems, better ways to solve conflict, not to resort to war, which is extremely primitive. So what you see here is some of the girls who trained with me, they're all dead now. And I managed to leave, it's a long story, and with blind optimism into the universe, thinking everything's going to be fine somehow, and having the help of a really loving, caring family, and the generosity of Australia and the Australian people, that I'm here now, a middle-aged woman, mother of two, living in the suburb, paying taxes, and as a high school teacher. So I haven't lost that spirit of that young girl who all those years ago decided to fight injustice, because I still carry some of her spirit, because I think as adults, it's our responsibility to fix up the mess that we have created, whether it's gun control or whether it's cleaning up the environment that we've made a mess out of, or whether to stop the wars that we've started all around the world. It's our responsibility. We need to clean it up. And it should not be to our young people who have to then put up with the mess that they've created. And that's why I've chosen to work with young people these days. And so that our young people can become the best they can be as amazing adults. Thank you.